Well, welcome to this evening's conversation with Nick Carr and Farhad Manju on the impact of technology nationally and in the liberal arts. Our participants are two of the most thoughtful and careful analysts of the influential role of technology in modern American society. On my left is Farhad Manju. He's the New York Times State of the Art columnist. Previously, he was a columnist for the Wall Street Journal and Slate, and was a writer for Wired magazine. He covers a wide range of tech-related topics, including the power of large tech companies, the role of technology in politics, and the introduction of a variety of new technological devices and discussions of those. He's the author of the prescient 2008 book, True Enough, Learning to Live in a Post-Fact Society, 2008. On my right is Nicholas Carr. In 2008, he published a widely discussed article in The Atlantic titled, Is Google Making Us Stupid? And just last week, he published in The Wall Street Journal what could be regarded as an updated sequel to that article, one titled, How Smartphones Hijack Our Minds. The first article was later expanded into his 2010 best-selling book, The Shallows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains, which was a Pulitzer Prize best-selling finalist in 2011. Since then, he's published the acclaimed book, The Glass Cage, How Our Computers Are Changing Us, and just last year, a collection of essays titled Utopia is Creepy and Other Provocations. Okay, we'll proceed as follows. For the first 45 minutes or so, I'll ask a series of open-ended questions to which our speakers will both have a chance to respond. They will also be free to respond to one another. We will then open it up for questions from the audience, beginning with a couple questions from students. Okay. The title for tonight's discussion is The Impact of Technology Nationally and in the Liberal Arts. So let's begin close at home with the liberal arts. One could say that Nick Carr's book, The Shallows, is in many respects an expanded reflection on the insightfulness of Marshall McLuhan's famous aphorism, the medium is the message. That is, even more important than the content of the material we read is the medium through which the information comes to us. The medium, in other words, carries an important intellectual ethic. Liberal arts colleges have made a lot of changes in the past two decades, eliminating hard copy course catalogs, reducing the number of printed journal subscriptions, investing in ebook services, using Glow and other online resources as central pedagogical tools. As a consequence, we don't read as many books. The number of books checked out of Sawyer Library has declined precipitously in the last 5 years. In 2012, 2013, students checked out over 34,000 hard copy books. Last year, it was less than 15,000. So the same trend one can observe among faculty. During the same time period, the number of books checked out by faculty declined from 12,000 to 6,000 books. If, as you argue in your book, Nick, use of digital media fundamentally affects the way we think, remember, read, and write, should we, as educators and as students in the liberal arts, be more cognizant of the effects of these changes and perhaps more critical of our use of new media?
I do think we should. And I think this is true, I think, of media and communications technologies in general. There tends to be a rush to adopt them very, very quickly because they allow us to do new and fun and meaningful things without kind of a skeptical or critical view of the deeper changes they might affect. And so I think when we saw the arrival of the internet in the form that everybody began using it with the World Wide Web, there was this general sense, and you know, you can see how we jumped to this conclusion that more information must be better. If we have quicker, broader access to more information, certainly that'll make us smarter. And I think what we've learned since then is that it's not that simple, that actually the way we gather information, the way information is presented to us, does have at least as much effect on our thinking as simple access to information does. And so I think what the mistake we made is confusing information with knowledge, or believing that more information would necessarily lead to more knowledge. And I think this is true in general in society, but I think it's particularly true in education, in the liberal arts, that there's actually a tension between digital technologies in the way they present information, the way they're designed, and the types of thinking, deep knowledge, knowledgeable thinking, contemplative thinking, reflective thinking, that traditionally, at least, we've wanted to inspire in students and hopefully in ourselves. The way that our digital devices in the internet and smartphones and social media deliver information, which tends to be very rapid fire in short bits, with deliberate design features that are not intended to get you to slow down, to tune out distractions, to think deeply, but are intended to get you to take in as much information as quickly as possible. And I think what we're learning, and we see it in education, we see it in society in general, is that actually that can have a very different and almost opposite effect to what we expected, that instead of deepening our knowledge, allowing us to see many points of view, it tends to lock us into a reactive form of thinking that gets more and more superficial the more and more quickly we jump from one bit of information to another. And so I think not only should we be more critical, more thoughtful about how we use the technology, how the technology is designed, and when we in making decisions about not using it, but that reconsideration is actually quite overdue.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Although I guess my caveat is I'm not really sure how effective reconsideration or even sort of thinking deeply about this stuff. I'm not sure that's very effective at kind of stopping the spread of technology. Like you mentioned, we both wrote books a while ago sort of warning about different aspects of this. And as far as I can tell, neither of those books had any much like effect at all in changing sort of the spread of technology. And it's because a lot of these technologies have very direct, and the ones we're talking about, you know, smartphones, for example, very direct and obvious benefits for the people who use them. And when you're talking about sort of social technologies like Facebook, for example, the kinds of immediate benefits are obvious, and the dangers are more, it's sort of like climate change, where they're more long-term, and they're spread out, and they're diffuse, and it's hard to tell, it's hard to know, for example, like what effect Facebook had on the election in any way. It's difficult for even, I think, Facebook to tell. I think we can tell that it had some effect, but quantifying that effect, figuring out sort of how dangerous Facebook is as a technology versus how beneficial it is as a technology is very difficult. And sort of stopping it, deciding what to do about it on a society-wide level, I think is almost impossible. Right now, you know, in Washington, they're thinking about sort of regulating the ads on Facebook and Google. There's some talk of like antitrust action against companies. But these are really kind of like, these would affect, I think, these technologies at a margin and maybe at the margins and affect some the companies. But I think the kind of the fundamental technology is sort of here to stay. And more than that, I'm not even sure that we as humans, like as individuals, have much capacity to kind of decide how it spreads or what to do about it.
Usually I'm not the optimist. I mean, usually I'm the pessimist, so this is putting me into a different position. But I mean, it's true that that I'm not sure, you know, my work or Farhad's that has had much effect. I mean, certainly, I think on individuals sometimes it does. But if you look at the broader picture, I mean, all the momentum is behind digital media, and it's, you know, in the last 10 years, it's kind of subsumed almost everything. And so I'm not, I think it's very, very hard. There's this concept in technology history called technological momentum, which says in the beginning stages of these big technological movements, society can influence them if you have the foresight to do it. But after a while, they get built into social structures, they get built into the economy, and then it becomes very, very hard to change the momentum of the technology. And I think there's a lot of truth to that, to what we're seeing now with digital technology, because it's not you know, some people say, oh, well, this is a matter of personal discipline, just change how you use your smartphone or whatever. And of course, that ignores the fact that there are expectations about our connectedness that are built into education, built into jobs, built into our social lives, and built very deeply. And so it becomes very difficult, even if you feel anxiety or something deeper about how the technology is shaping your life and your thoughts, it does become very, very hard to change it. On the other hand, I think, to be a little more optimistic, I think if you look back through history, when you get a dominant cultural status quo, and kind of one of the ironies of Silicon Valley is that it's always said we're anti-status quo and we're going to disrupt anything, but it's very much the status quo now. When you get this kind of dominant cultural status quo, you often see a countercultural movement begin to boil up against it. And I would not rule that out. These things tend to come from the young, in fact, almost always. And I would not be surprised if in the next 10 years we see something like that emerge where people en masse start, particularly young people, start rejecting things like Facebook. So I still think it can change, but it's going to be, I think if it does change, it's going to be something more like that, like a deep cultural reaction to the dominant status quo.
Just a quick follow-up on that. I mean, isn't the notion that, it's spreading, there's nothing we can do, kind of acquiescing to a kind of technological determinism that as humans we should probably not so easily give into? Or?
I think I would agree with Nick. I think that in the early stages, it's possible. It's hard to know sort of in the early stages how important a given technology is. I mean, like, you know, I write about new technologies and I'm constantly having to decide whether the thing I'm writing about is a real thing or just some like vaporware that that's not gonna be, you know, important next year. So the difficulty then is sort of knowing which technologies whose sort of rise you should try to influence or change. I mean, there's this huge discussion among Silicon Valley billionaires now about like whether or not artificial intelligence is gonna like be the end of human society, gonna like kill us all, or gonna be sort of the savior of human society. And you know, there are, so Mark Zuckerberg and like the people at Google are on the pro AI side, and Elon Musk thinks it's gonna be like the worst thing ever. And you know, they're all smart people and they all sort of understand technology and they all have their biases. I don't know which of them to believe. And I think they all make good arguments. And if you were to think we as a society should do something about AI, first you'd have to decide, should we do something to accelerate AI, or should we do something to, you know, stop AI? And there are people who offer arguments on either of those positions that are compelling. I think what happens is, right, so the risk is you can sort of just, you're acquiescing to the rise and you're saying it's inevitable and we can't do anything about it. I mean, I see that. But on the other hand, I'm not sure at the early stages you can just sort of, there is a lot to do because you don't know how it's going to turn out.
And it's certainly true that a lot of the big things turn out to be not what everybody was talking about or worried about, but something that just comes and kind of takes over. And so the smartphone, I think, is a great example of that. It was the first iPhone went on sale just 10 years ago, and people saw it. Nobody was quite sure whether it was going to be a big deal or not, but more deeply, nobody foresaw how it would completely take over personal computing, completely take over media. And that just happened in 10 years. And by when I say nobody, I mean the technological people too didn't really.
Not even Apple. I mean, sort of
yeah,
knew that, right?
Yeah, but I do think we can learn something by looking back. Look, at least we can learn something that maybe we can apply going forward when we look back, particularly at the history of the internet, which at a legal level was given special status from the very, very beginning. And so you had a company like Amazon exempt from collecting state sales tax. You know, the local bookstore, the bookstore downtown Williamstown or whatever, had to collect tax, but you had this big company this fast-growing company in Oregon that was special. You know, the internet's special. So let's not block progress by forcing online retailers to collect state sales tax. And then you had in 1996 a very important law, the Communications Decency Act, in which was a provision that basically gave internet companies carte blanche to not be responsible for the content that went through their systems. And this was very, I'm not saying that was necessarily a bad law, because it's very, very hard to figure out how something like Google could get up to scale while being sued all the time for stuff that was on its system. But the law was much too broad, I think. And now we're beginning to realize some of the negative effects of saying, you know, we can distinguish the network from the content that goes through the network. And more recently, the Federal Election Commission said that, you know, political advertising on the internet doesn't have to follow the rules that it does in print and on TV. And so we've treated, because we fear, you know, slowing down progress, we've given special treatment to the internet. And I think it's really backfired in a fundamental way, even if you go back and say, well, it made sense at the time. And now there's going to be a lot of legal maneuvering, we're already in the midst of it, to figure out, you know, where should we have been from the start. And what I think we can learn from that is that we should be wary of people giving special status to new technologies simply because they're new, and raising these kind of fears that, oh, if you don't treat them special and give them much more freedom that other companies and other media don't have, you're going to slow down progress. I think it's okay to actually say, no, we're not going to do that, even if it means progress slows down a little bit, because that way we're going, by being more deliberate, by not giving too many breaks too quickly to these big technologies, we can then keep to ourselves and keep to society more control, whether it's legal or regulatory or whatever, as the technology develops, rather than having it sprint forward with lots of good effects but also lots of bad effects, and then having to back up and figure out, you know, can we at this point make fundamental changes, which becomes much, much harder.
Okay, having begun talking about some of the tech giants, first, a quick observation. A lot of the leaders in Silicon Valley are aware of the effects of these technologies, so much so that, we were talking about this earlier, they prefer to send their kids to schools that don't use computers and smartphones and so forth. So there's an awareness of its effects on our thinking and so forth. But Farhad, you've written a lot about the growing influence of these large tech giants, Amazon, Google, Facebook. Can you talk about some of the nature and consequences of their growing influence, if only unwitting, but particularly on the political process and on politics today?
Yeah, I mean, so it's sort of been a fascinating change to watch how the tech industry works over the time that I've covered it. When I first started writing about tech, there was sort of one dominant technology company, Microsoft, and kind of everyone else was, you know, trying to figure out how to overthrow Microsoft or how to survive, because everyone believed that, you know, Microsoft would come for them. And over that, you know, the internet just led to this huge change where it allowed there to be kind of all of these upstarts that were competitors to Microsoft in various ways. Google, you know, the most obvious example, but Amazon too, and later Facebook. And it also, you know, the internet sort of fueled, I think you could argue the internet kind of fueled the rise of the rebirth of Apple in various ways. You know, it made the Mac more, you know, accessible because you didn't have to think about software as much. And you know, so Apple came back as a force. And now we have these five companies that are essentially in charge of kind of every part of our digital lives. You know, they're collectively inescapable. You can maybe do without one of them. You know, you pick one. Like some people say, you know, I can live without Microsoft, or some people can live without Apple. But there are very few. I think there's almost nobody who can live without any of them. And you know, you probably have two or three of them that know more about you than, you know, your spouse knows about you, than sort of anyone else in the world knows about you. And so because they have such, you know, such a hold over our lives, we're also noticing that they're sort of in ways we didn't anticipate, kind of in charge of society at large too. I think that there were people who were worried about sort of the effect of Facebook on the election before the election. And there were people who were worried about, you know, the effect of Google and YouTube. But no one thought it would be a big issue. No one thought it would be sort of that we would war. No one thought that a foreign government could use these technologies to affect the political process in the United States. I think that was, you know, is sort of out of the realm of the imagination of, I think, almost everyone. I mean, I don't remember reading a single person predicting that. And you know, I in a book suggested that the internet was making us sort of more prone to hoax stories and fake news. I didn't call it fake news. But I didn't expect that kind of lying to the degree that we see now in politics, you know, just sort of the complete like factlessness of much of what we read in the news, you know, I didn't predict this would be so prevalent. I think these, so anyway, to answer your question, the kind of the effect that these technologies and more importantly, the companies that run them have had on our political process has just been profound, has been, you know, more than I think even they understood, appreciated. And the other thing to remember about them is they are mostly, especially the new ones, they're mostly, you know, they're engineering-led companies. The way they think about things is mostly through the lens of data and engineering and not how to run a society, not sort of government and history and politics. They're not experts at those topics. They're not experts at sort of in dealing with questions like how should the media run, how should this population of people be informed. That's not their purpose, that's not why they were created, and that's not their sort of realm of expertise, but they're suddenly in charge of this. And so I think for them also it's a surprise the degree, you know, the amount of kind of responsibility people are demanding of them, the sudden importance that they find themselves in, I think, is a surprise to them.
Yeah, I think that's right. And also, their view has always been that kind of history doesn't matter because everything that came before the internet must be bad. It must be or kind of insufficient, and we can do everything better now. And so that meant that a lot of these people who run these companies don't know really very much outside of the realm of technology. They don't know about history because they think it's kind of irrelevant. And now all of a sudden, all that kind of deeper perspective that might be very useful for these people, we're learning that they don't have it. And so it's got to come from somewhere else. I would also, you know, particularly when we're thinking about how the technology influences our people's acceptance of, you know, misinformation, fake news, lies, or whatever, or even how it influenced the polarization of political polarization of views. You know, it seems to me there's three parties involved here. There's the creators of misinformation and fake news, who might be Russian agents who want to influence our election. They might be scam artists who want to, you know, figure out how to game the advertising system to make money on Facebook or Google or whatever. There's the actual tech companies that are running the networks, the Facebooks and the Googles of the world, who I think bear a lot of responsibility for this. But then there's also us, the people who are taken in. And I don't think we should let the public off the hook. And this doesn't mean I'm removing responsibility from the other two parties, but it does seem to me that there's another effect that technology is having, in that it's making us less thoughtful, less skeptical, less critical, less able to take different points of view, and hence more susceptible to being influenced by misinformation, by lies and half-truths. And I think if you look at some of the studies that have been done about how technology, our modern technology, influences us, you can see pretty clear signs that simply having, your phone with you all the time. And this is something I wrote about in the Wall Street Journal that Jim mentioned. There's now studies that show that simply having your phone within reach or on a table in front of you, even if it's off, even if you're not using it, takes up some of your headspace, some of your cognitive capacity, as psychologists call it, for the simple reason that we've never had anything, any object that was as interesting to us as our phone. Because if you think about it, everything's in your phone. You know, friends having conversations, news headlines, music, video, all sorts of information. And what happens, and this is consistent with what we know about how our brains work, is if you put an object like that around you all the time, as one of the psychology professors who've studied this told me, just suppressing the desire to glance, to use your phone takes up some of your cognitive capacity. And as a result, I don't think it's any surprise that our brains are, in a way, being hijacked by the technology itself. And the more that happens, the less able you are to really sustain your attention, to think conceptually, to think critically. So the technology shapes, I think, our individual susceptibility to, our individual susceptibility to fake news and our ability to think critically and skeptically about it. And unfortunately, we have these big companies, and I'm not saying they do this for nefarious purposes, but are quite happy that we're always thinking about our phones and always want to use our phones. And they're designing their apps and designing the hardware to magnify our attachment to these devices as much as possible. So it does seem to me a very deep and profound shift in the way people fundamentally are doing their thinking now.
Right, it's like if the cigarette companies sort of like knew what you liked about cigarettes and sort of could change cigarettes as you use them to make them more addictive. Like that's the sort of best way to think about what Facebook can do and what Google can do and what Apple can do. They sort of understand what you like about your phone, and they're able to change your phone from afar so they can just sort of make it more likable. So, you know, it's like the most interesting object in the world that's also dynamic and responds to you and run by for-profit companies. It's pretty bad.
Yeah. So there was a very interesting article in The Guardian a week or so ago that interviewed some designers of apps and stuff that are having deep second thoughts. And one of the most interesting was there's a gesture that's become very commonplace when you want to refresh a feed on any social media you're on or pretty much anything, which is you swipe down on the screen. And it turns out, you know, that was just somebody came up with that by sort of happenstance. I had to figure out how do we allow a person to see new information to see whether, you know, somebody's posted something new. Well, we'll have them swipe down. The company who pioneered it was bought by Twitter. Twitter said, hey, this is a pretty good thing. And now it became a standard. But what's very interesting about it is that, as these designers say, it's very similar to when people are playing slot machines. It's the same kind of psychological dependency, because what you're doing, and this is quite clear with people who become addicted to slot machines, is that it's this sense that every time they pull the lever or push the button, something new is going to happen and it might give them a reward. And that's very similar to when you swipe down, because maybe somebody has liked something you put up, or maybe there's a new message you don't know, but it could be there. And so it breeds this compulsive type of behavior. And the interesting thing is that these companies can now refresh their feeds automatically whenever they want, so you don't actually have to have people doing that. But the reason it continues to be the default standard is because they know that this tactile refreshing motion is actually very addictive and very compulsive, and so they don't want to get rid of it because they want you to do that as often as possible. And it shows how, you know, as Farhad said, there are extremely sophisticated behavioral scientists that work at these companies and designers, and they are, you know, they can monitor on over millions and billions of instances every day exactly how tiny little changes in the way these things are designed, how they can have big effects increasing your dependency in your compulsive use of them.
While we're on the topic of these tech giants, one of the concerns of their growing influence is related to issues of privacy and surveillance. Farhad, you alluded to that. Are people aware of how much information these companies have on citizens and how they're using or will use this information? And what other consequences might you anticipate from the information gathering powers these companies have as it concerns issues of privacy and surveillance?
I feel like of the many issues that technology sort of raise, I'm less worried about the privacy thing. It's sort of an there's no real reason that I'm. It's one of those things where I think we just decided that we were gonna trade our privacy to these companies for in return for these services. And for a lot of people, that balance feels okay. There's a lot of worry about privacy on Facebook, and Facebook sort of constantly. Facebook started as a more private network in its early days, like everything, you know, it was limited in the amount of people who could sign up, and also everything you posted was more locked down, and over time they, opened that up in a great way, and then there, every time they opened it up, there was a controversy about it, but what they found was, you know, people were willing to make that trade, that was something that people really didn't think was, you know, they thought that it was beneficial to broadcast their thoughts rather than, you know, keep them hidden. And you know, I think we've seen some change in that. I think there's, you know, after the Snowden revelations, people got a little more worried about it. And then, you know, I think the rise of Snapchat is interesting because it sort of, in many ways, was like the anti-Facebook, where you would post something and you wouldn't have to worry about as much about the kind of long-term effects of those because it would disappear. And that's been, you know, an interesting paradigm and like has been obviously very popular. And I think, you know, and Facebook has totally copied it. And so it's sort of been widespread, but I think they've reached this kind of balance where, as far as I can tell, it's not one of the bigger worries of the technologies.
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point people know that they're being tracked all the time and that everything they do is being collected and analyzed and bought and sold, and it doesn't seem to change anybody's behavior. I mean, a few people, but most people seem to be willing either to consciously make the trade-off that I'll give you everything, just give me free stuff, or they're willing to kind of not think about it deeply enough to get worried about it. There are certainly dangers here, though. Beyond the question of privacy, there's a question of once all this information is collected, it can be used to manipulate you because they know your triggers very, very deeply. And you don't know that it's going on. This is one of the problems is that, you know, Silicon Valley companies like to talk about transparency and everybody should be kind of totally visible, but, you know, get close to their algorithms and you're not gonna see what's going on. And so a danger here is that we may be manipulated in many ways without knowing that we're being manipulated. And then there's also a weird thing going on. There's a woman named Shoshana Zuboff, who's a business professor, who's come up with this, with a term, the surveillance economy. And what she argues is that we've seen a fundamental shift in the capitalist economy from companies who wanted to know something about you so they could actually make a product that you'd be willing to spend money for. And then once that transaction took place, kind of that was the end of it, that you were either happy or you weren't, and they went ahead and tried to make an even better product. That's kind of shifted with the big internet companies who are all about making money through collecting data about you all the time. And so you begin to move away from this kind of symbiotic relationship between, you know, you give some information to a company and they make a product that you're willing to pay money for and is useful to you, to this kind of more exploitative form of capitalism where you're getting free stuff and you're not having to pay anything, but you're giving away this deep information about yourself, and you don't know what's going on with that information behind the scenes. And I'm probably not being as clear as she was, but she really you know, makes the point that this is something fundamentally different in the economy, in the consumer economy. And it may ultimately undermine the kind of relationship we've had with companies and also give these companies, and I think we're seeing this, and Farhad's writing about it, enormous power, unlike any product maker has had in the past.
Right, I mean, for a number of these companies, their products now are the data. So, you know, Google's products are, if you think about sort of their future innovations, things like self-driving cars, or they're working on a bunch of different artificial intelligence ways to, you know, diagnose medical conditions, for example. All of these products are based on huge collections of data. You know, some of it is data they're collecting. A lot of it is data, you know, from us. So, like, if you use a mapping program, if you use Google Maps or Waze or something, you're giving them a lot of information about your driving habits. That information is going to be used in, you know, their self-driving car program. When you use the web, when you use their translation program, you're sort of telling them stuff that goes to the furtherance of that program, and so their artificial intelligence translation programs are sort of better than anyone else's, but they're better than anyone else's because, like, everyone uses them. And so it gives them this enormous, you know, like, it makes them indomitable, right? Like, you can't come up with a better system than theirs if you're a startup or something, because they have all the data, and the reason they have all the data is because everyone uses them. And there are a number of products like that.
Okay, I want one last question, then we'll open up to the audience. And this is on the effects of technology on civic life. And here I'm thinking of arguments put forth in books like Robert Putnam's Bowling Alone, Sherry Turkle's Alone Together. Both of them see technology as a cause of declining social capital, declining, you know, human social connection. And so I guess what I would ask you is, how do you see new information technologies influencing human relationships, community, civic life? Let's start.
Well, this is still, to me, kind of a mysterious subject, because I can see sort of both sides, and I think we don't, even now we don't quite know what's going on. I mean, on the one hand, you know, people are able to converse with other people that aren't there, present, in ways that are easier than ever were before, and there has to be something good about that. On the other hand, and again, this comes through with some of the research, if you look at how, you know, that ability to converse with anyone, anytime, influences the way people interact in person, even with their close friends, their spouse, their children, it does tend to intrude on that. Because when you're having a conversation with someone in person, you're thinking about, even if you're not looking at your phone, you're thinking, some part of your mind is thinking about, gee, I could be online and talking to all sorts of people. And that does kind of tend to, at least the evidence so far suggests, create more superficiality in direct relationships. Now, how that plays out over the long term, I'm not really sure. But on the broader subject, so that's the interpersonal side. On the broader subject of civic life, I think just as we've kind of confused information with knowledge, I think we've also confused communication with community. And what we're starting to see is that actually you can have more communication end up creating more polarized society, end up creating a way for groups who have pretty noxious views to come together in ways they couldn't before and begin to have greater influence over our civic life than ever before. So I think, you know, I think at the civic level, we're seeing some trends that are pretty disturbing. And I think it's not all about technology by any means, but I do think that this sense, and Mark Zuckerberg says this over and over again, that, oh, more communication inevitably has to breed kind of better communities and stuff, which is complete nonsense. And he continues to say it, even though all the evidence from his own network should be convincing him otherwise. But it's very, very hard for us, I think, to realize that communication in and of itself, by simply amping up its frequency, does not necessarily lead to better communities.
Yeah, so if the, I think the argument of the Putnam book and Sherry Turkle and sort of others who've talked about this is that, you know, technology's in some way made us antisocial. And I think what we're seeing is perhaps a bigger danger is that technology has made us too social. Like, it's made us think of, like, kind of online social life as the primary part of our lives, and it has given us the power to create social groups that, you know, span geography, but that because of, you know, people can find groups of like-minded others, has given them those kinds of groups huge power, like power that we may not have can have anticipated. I mean, the rise of the alt-right is like a very good example of this. You know, Breitbart, from what we can tell, kind of had outsized influence in the election in terms of getting its sort of point of view and stories into kind of mainstream media. And the way they did that was because they have groups online that are very good at figuring out points in kind of how the media works, figuring out how to get their view into kind of the larger media. They're dedicated, they're sort of, you can think of them as kind of like perhaps the opposite of the people, the kind of volunteers who run Wikipedia. Like, they are trying to get a story that may not be accurate, but that may be sensational or beneficial to their point of view, and they're doing it, you know, voluntarily on social networks, and they're doing it really well. And there's, you know, there are, and, you know, the Russian troll group sort of did the same thing, but working for a foreign government. I think we have this power now to create social groups that, like, have outsized power in the real world, and, like, the real world sort of doesn't know that. So, you know, that's the dangerous mix.
Okay, good. So let's take some questions from the audience, and if there are any students who would like to ask questions, we'll begin with them. So, why don't you go?
So assuming that, like, technology becomes, like, the thing where people get all their information on, like, I know, like, I use social media a lot to get, like, my news and, like, instant things that happen, like, how should, like, school curriculums evolve to, like, accommodate for, like, all this, like, all these ways that information comes at us?
So the question was, in as much as you gather information via social media, how, in the context of an educational situation, should you monitor that, or?
Okay,
how should we be taught to take in that information?
Well, I guess I would throw out two things. One thing is that I think schools have been too quick to buy into the assumption that more technological intensity leads to a higher quality education. And as a result, we're seeing a push, and this is not only at the college university level, but down to, you know, elementary school, to get kids to spend more time learning through screens. And it seems to me one thing we can do is begin to change that assumption and realize that actually, in many ways, screens don't, just by the very nature of how they present information, they don't encourage people to learn how to pay attention, to learn how to screen out distractions, to learn how to think deeply and read deeply. So I'm not arguing for banning computers and iPads and stuff from schools, but I am arguing that there's still something to be said for different forms of media for different purposes, and we shouldn't, you know, throw away printed books or printed articles or other ways to gather information, because they do, even if it's the same text or the same information, they do encourage a different way to interact with the material. And as far as, you know, teaching people about screen information, you know, I think on the one hand, having liberal arts education that teaches people to put information into context and to be naturally critical about it is has never been so important, it seems to me, as it is now. And that argues not only for kind of a classical education, but applying those lessons to the screen itself and making sure that from a young age, people grow up understanding that, you know, this information is not necessarily true, it can be intended to manipulate you, and you need to be critical about it and skeptical about it.
Yeah, I would agree with both of that. I would just say one difficulty is that for educators is that the technology changes so quickly that it's difficult to figure out, and I think there's also sort of a mismatch usually between the like what the educators know and what the students use. So it's difficult to know sort of how students are getting information and how to teach them sort of the correct way versus what, and how to know that like a new technology is perhaps beneficial and to know the dangers about it. I think all that seems very difficult. I don't envy people who are trying to teach this stuff because I have two kids and my main sort of parenting question is how much technology to give them, how to monitor that, and because you want to both prepare them for a future in which technology is going to be, you know, ubiquitous. See, I feel like it's not good to kind of shield them from technology. On the other hand, I can see how it has ruined my own life, and so I don't want it to ruin theirs.
What do you make of the public faith in technology to save us from climate change? And in a sort of horrifying way, do you think that the political instability or electrical outages or material shortages brought about by environmental disaster offers a kind of like alternative to this hyper-technological future that you're envisaging?
Did you hear that?
Do we need it repeated or?
No, everyone heard it.
Okay. So the first question was what do I think of the possibility of technology sort of mitigating some of those problems or of climate change? It's once again one of those things where it seems like so electric cars, for example, seem obviously better. Self-driving cars seem like obviously better. It seems like it would be better if cars were safer, if cars ran on like a, you know, more efficient type of fuel. But it's difficult to say that like everyone should do that and we should, you know, I was thinking about cars when you were talking about this, Nick, like we give electric cars a great subsidy. And I think that the argument on the part of climate change people is to, you know, push that transformation for the environment. You know, that transformation is going to come with cars being more connected, with cars. You can foresee sort of all kinds of problems because of that. You can also think, like, one of the questions about self-driving cars is, like, if people can drive them, if the cars drive themselves, would we just drive more? Would we live further away from work? Because, like, driving is not such a bad thing. Would it, like, lead to, in that way, would it, you know, lead to, you know, detrimental environmental effects? So this is, again, an instance where, like, things look attractive at the start, but it's hard to play out kind of the effects of them in the long run.
Yeah, and I think technology can and will provide an important role in dealing with climate issues. Many of the problems came from technology, and you can solve some of those problems with technology. One of the dangers, a danger in thinking that, looking forward and saying, well, technology is going to solve all this. You know, we're going to figure out how to re-engineer climate completely or re-engineer the Earth completely, is that it makes you complacent in the present. And we kind of see this is a typical theme, again, hate to berate Silicon Valley, but this is a typical theme. And to come back to self-driving cars, for instance, one of the themes about self-driving cars is that in the future, when cars are completely automated, we won't have accidents anymore. And so tons of lives will be saved. That may well be true at some point in the future. And it's probably going to be quite a ways into the future. But what's happening right now, we're seeing, after many, many years where traffic fatalities went down, we're seeing them begin to go up, to spike. Why is that? It's because people are using their phones in their cars. There might be other reasons, but it's pretty clear that people are distracted. Not only are they using their phones, but kind of the interior of cars are becoming these computer displays, which, when you think about it, is really a stupid thing to put into a car when you want people to pay attention to the road. And what's frustrating is that you don't see the tech companies grappling with this immediate issue where people are actually dying. And it's actually much, much easier to deal with by regulating, by preventing people from using their phone when they're driving. It's actually not that hard to do if you really wanted to do it. And yet, by saying, well, we have bigger dreams ahead and we're gonna solve the entire problem of traffic fatalities in the long run, it makes these immediate issues seem less pressing. And it also means that they don't have to take actions that would reduce people's use of phones and stuff. While I think that, you know, in the long run, I'm sure we'll have technological breakthroughs that will help with climate problems and any other problem, we shouldn't assume that technology in and of itself at some future point is going to solve everything. We should really deal with the here and now while also, you know, while also encouraging longer range engineering and development and science that might also play a big role in solving the problems.
So both speakers were very critical of how quickly we've adopted technology into society, but I personally feel like that's a very developed world, like Western perspective, because many like countries such as in Asia have adopted technology very rapidly. Like a few decades ago, they didn't even have electricity, and now they're very industrialized. And that's changed their societies and in a beneficial way. If you look at like the Arab Spring movement, how the connectivity of Facebook helped them, or just how technology has helped bring education to areas that were underserved, or technology has literally brought people out of poverty in the developed world. And so many of these like big technology companies that are like creating this innovation are based in America. So do you still think we should like possibly like slow down how quickly we adopt technology when it has like these much larger global effects on and benefiting like the global society as a whole?
Did anyone hear that? Yes.
I think that's a good point, and I will sort of cop to the idea, like most of my analysis on this is about the United States and Europe, and I think that technology definitely has a different role in the developing world. You know, if you start from a different place, the effects are different, and you know, the possibility that there's a company right now using drones to transport medical equipment to places in, I think it's Rwanda, that are not well served by roads, and so they can send like blood samples to faraway hospitals from a central location very quickly. It's sort of like they're leapfrogging the infrastructure of like roads and other kinds of communication, other kinds of local infrastructure. I'm not worried about that technology. I think you could perhaps foresee dangers of that, but like for what they're doing, for sort of the benefit of that, it seems kind of obvious. There's other ways where, you know, you can, like, there's other ways where technology may change a society in ways that that you can't predict, even in the developing world. And so there could be similar dynamics to what we see here, you know, in terms of, like, how it affects elections in those places. Like, if everyone used social networks in various developing countries, and if we know that Russia or the United States or others can affect elections in those places through those technologies. Like, you can imagine that kind of thing would be happening, not just in the United States. And so, you know, some of these problems may have like worldwide implications as well.
Yeah, I think your point is very well taken, and there's no doubt that some of these technologies are really helping people in ways that are very different from how they're playing out here. And certainly the rise of cellular telephony has allowed people who, you know, has allowed countries that building out a landline network would have been onerous and would have taken forever to kind of leapfrog that and have telephony available to them. In fact, one of the ironies is that cellular technology has actually made phone calls worse in the US compared to what it was with landlines, and they're still terrible. Cell calls are still problematic, which is one reason I think people don't make as many calls anymore. But it has a very different effect if you're in a country that doesn't have a landline infrastructure. On the other hand, I think a lot, and I guess I'm repeating what Farhad just said, there, it's also can be a very much a double-edged sword in other ways. For instance, you can look at the Arab Spring and say, and this is true of communication technologies in general, I think that new ones tend to allow people to communicate by definition, but also to organize much more easily than was possible before. We've seen that with fax machines, we've seen it with all sorts of things, but it's certainly true with social media, and that can have a very positive effect. On the other hand, these things are public, and it gives, if you're an authoritarian regime or a totalitarian regime, it gives a very good way to keep track of your people and to figure out who's organizing them and to go after them and put them in jail, and we see that as well. So even at that level, it seems to me that it's a two-edged sword, and we need to be very careful in jumping to conclusions that says, well, or in looking at just the good thing in ignoring the bad. I think that's just as dangerous as doing the opposite. And, you know, having centralized control over so much information about people's lives, that can be very powerful for people, but it can also be used to abuse people.
And the one other thing I'd add is, like, you still have the problem of, I mean, it actually is a worse problem when there's four companies on the West Coast of the United States that are controlling the information for all those people, you know, outside of the United States. Like, it's kind of tolerable when you're an American citizen and there's, you know, four or five American companies that are, like, in charge of all of your information, but you really have very little kind of rights or say about what those companies do and ability to affect them when you're, you know, somewhere in Africa or Asia and, you know, don't have a lot of money and don't have a lot of political power. Like, that could be a long-term danger.
Okay, others, not just students now, if you'd like to ask a question. Yeah, Jessica.
So you talk about the detrimental effects on technology on memory and attention and how, like, companies design, you know, their products to make you, like, feel like you need them. Should companies be more responsible when developing and, like, creating new technologies? And if so, like, how would you encourage them to do so if it's, like, contrary to, like, their goals of making you want to use their products?
Well, I would like them to be more responsible. They're not going to care what I want. But there are two things. One is that these are companies and they're in business. They have shareholders. They want to make as much profit as possible. They like to say that they're not in it for money, but ultimately, once you become a profit-making company, you're in it for money. And they're not going to go against their business interests in a big way. They're not going to Facebook isn't going to redesign its program to discourage people from using it. That's not going to happen. But also, I think beyond that, I also don't think they see it as a problem, actually. I think they believe, they have a view of our intellectual lives that doesn't really put much emphasis on contemplative thought or reflective thought or backing away from the flow of information in order to think more deeply about something or sitting in a quiet spot and reading for a long time. I think their view of the human mind is very similar to their view of a computer, that the more information you can push through it as quickly as possible, the better it is. And this reflects I think this reflects kind of their lives as people who have been immersed in computers, but also just reflects what they value about their own thinking. So I think that A, they're not going to change on their own accord to go against their business interests, and also I don't think they see it as a problem.
And as to the question of what to do about it, the difficulty there is, so like if you think about, so Facebook and Google particularly, they're making information technology. They're making sort of products that are difficult to regulate because they're broadly protected by the First Amendment in the United States. It's difficult to tell Facebook that you have to be more responsible, like you have to create a news feed that shows a variety of views and maybe is slower and maybe shows you like longer articles and doesn't prompt you all the time to refresh. It's difficult to sort of tell them how to do their product because, you know, we don't have any kind of mechanism in the United States to do that. And even in, you know, Europe has tried to, European governments and regulators have tried to do some of this, like for example in France and some other European countries, or I guess it's all of Europe now, there's this right to be forgotten legislation, which, so if there's information about you on Google, that even if it's true, but it's just not, you think it should be private, like documents about like if you had a foreclosure or some kind of other like legal proceeding against you and it's on Google and you're a private individual, you can ask regulators or authorities in those governments to ask to force the search engines to remove it. And in those, you know, in many other parts of the world, privacy is sort of is given a higher legal standard sometimes than free speech. In the United States, it's different, and there's no right to be forgotten, and it's very hard to see how you could have that kind of thing. So in many ways, like the First Amendment and just our general attitude in the United States to companies and the kind of power they are allowed to have over our lives makes it much more difficult to regulate them.
Do you, just to follow up and just, can I ask a question? Do you, right now, these companies are in the midst of kind of a PR nightmare. There's a lot of press focus. I don't know how that translates into public nervousness, but there's a lot of press focus on them and fake news and stuff. Do you think that, in the long run, do you think that will change the way they operate?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think Facebook never wants to be accused of, you know, being in the middle of another election. And so I think, I've spoken to people at Facebook, including Mark Zuckerberg, about this. I think they genuinely were surprised by the level, by sort of the way that Facebook was used in the election, and on the part of Zuckerberg specifically, he has sort of started to think about how to change Facebook and sort of think about Facebook's role in the world more deeply. I think that's genuine. But on the other hand, you know, like they are, you know, corporations that have incentives, and I don't know that they will change as much as people want them to change, or is it, you know, we think they should change. I think that they will sort of, for example, in the specific question about regulating political ads on these companies, on Facebook and Google, like I think they will, give in to some form of regulation that, you know, is similar to how we regulate ads on other platforms. But, you know, I don't know if that'll change much. It's not going to be a big deal to them. It'll be like a small thing, and that probably will be the end of it.
Okay, any other questions?
Yeah. This is more focused on Mr. Carr's work, but I'd love to hear from both of you. We read The Shallows a couple of years ago in a seminar I taught on the history of reading, and students loved it. I loved it. It was really insightful. But we were struck by some of the things you said about reading practices and how they're changing. Particular issues like the hypertext in Kindles and other reading methods, bringing commentaries and other things, dictionary definitions that can distract you. Like you said, it turns reading into a team sport. And the notion that publications become an ongoing process rather than a discrete event. But one of the things that struck us, having gone through kind of a history of reading up until that, is a lot of these things were not new. In fact, they were ways of interacting with written text that were fundamental in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, when people read almost everything with commentaries, whether they were late imperial Chinese novels or biblical texts. And reading was very much a social event. And of course, in the manuscript culture, publication was always an ongoing changing process. Everything was recopied and changed. And so we wondered if some of these changes are, in fact, they are changes, but they're changes that move back to, ironically enough, earlier modes of interacting with text. And just wondered what your thoughts on that were.
Yeah, and I think there are many ways to interact with a text, and there are many ways to read, and all of them have their benefits. I mean, certainly reading has, there's always been a social element to it. Even if it's non-technological, you talk to other people about what you read and you exchange ideas. And if you get really interested, you dig into the commentaries, you dig into the literary criticism, and I think that's all to the good. My concern is that the kind of social, distracted, and also very kind of practical modes of reading, where you're not reading for a literary experience, but you're reading to extract information, which is also valuable at times, they, thanks to the technology, they can crowd out the way of reading that I think was democratized by the printed book, in particular, you know, when printed books became cheap in the 19th century or whatever, which is a kind of a deep literary reading, which I think is also valuable, where you're not jumping out to commentary, you're immersing yourself in an argument or you're immersing yourself in a story. And I think, you know, I think that's something relatively new, but also something extraordinarily valuable that hopefully we'll hang on to, in that we won't sacrifice that for the types of reading that I think screen reading tends to encourage, which is something different, valuable as well, but something different.
On your general point of returning to sort of an earlier time, I think sometimes technology does that. One of the things that's interesting about sort of thinking about the mass media era in how we communicated is that, you know, when I was born during sort of after TV was invented, for me, TV felt like the way that the way that news was communicated, the way that information was communicated. Newspapers felt that way, and it turns out, I think it'll turn out that the kind of era where there were one or two or three major sources of information for the public would be, you know, just was just kind of a blip in human society. And, you know, before the mass media era, when people, you know, printed pamphlets and magazines and small newspapers, it was much more similar to kind of the present. And in some ways we kind of moved away from that as a society, at least in the United States, and then are trying to figure out a way back to that. And how to kind of survive as a big industrial country with kind of the old way of communicating.
Okay, we have time for one more question. You had your hand up there.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of emphasis in your sort of problematizing technology on these sort of centralized corporate models of making technology and software. Whereas one movement or form of making technology that I've both found academically interesting and beneficial in my personal life is free and open source software. I was wondering if you could comment on what you thought about, if you thought that mode of software production had any potential to mitigate some of these problems, or if you think it either lacks its potential or is simply too technical and esoteric to really influence things.
Yeah, it's really interesting. You know, at the start of the internet, there were people very optimistic about the internet, and the people who, you know, were working on the internet were also part of this idea of software becoming free. Like the opposition to Microsoft in the 90s was not just about this one company controlling everything, but it's also the idea that it was to many of their opponents, it was sort of anathema that they were selling software. And you could imagine that if that side had won, that like everything about the internet would have changed. And so instead of Twitter being ruled by a single company, you could imagine Twitter as being just like a protocol, you know, like email, where like no one really owns it and everything is just kind of decentralized and passed around, and like you tweet something and no company kind of has control over it. And you could, I think there are technical ways to achieve a lot of what the tech companies do now, particularly the kind of software-only companies you can think about is that could work in other economic models. The reason those took off is because like they were able to, you know, the one company controls everything model was just faster. Like it was able to kind of do a lot, you know, create more attractive and better and it, collectively, you know, that kind of model that started with like Yahoo and the other early internet companies and then moved to Google and Facebook. You know, they're just in many ways they can be faster than the ways that we could organize before. I think it's an open question now. It could be that like communications technologies have gotten so advanced that maybe organizing some kind of software effort that could be a rival to Facebook and Google, maybe that's more possible now. Maybe that's like the way out of this.
Yeah, and I don't. This isn't going to respond to your particular question. I'm really not sure what the answer is to that. I guess I'm a little disillusioned that a lot of open source software just gets funneled into kind of very controlled corporate products, and the other stuff tends to be on the periphery. But I do think it was interesting. Just recently, AOL announced that it was discontinuing Instant Messenger, which used to be a really, really big thing. But one thing, and I hadn't thought about this, one thing that came out in the reporting is that at some point, Instant Messenger was forced to open up its system to other companies who wanted to use, you know, what's referred to as the social graph, the connections between people and the naming system and stuff. And it does seem to me that is a very that was a very interesting decision that could be applied to a company like Facebook. That, you know, Facebook now is this highly controlled, huge utility in some ways, and Zuckerberg himself has referred to it as a utility, though he doesn't do that anymore. But if you have it, then you could force them to open up that graph, to open up, you know, people's naming system and their identities to other companies. And that would be a very interesting thing to do. And the fact that it was done before seems to me to suggest that there's no reason why we should consider that an impossibility. And opening that up, kind of breaking apart Facebook from the communications infrastructure that's been built around it, might be one way to undermine its power, but also to create a lot of innovation in how that's used, rather than to keep such centralized control.
All right, thank you all for coming tonight, and thank you to our discussants, Nick Carr and Farhad Manjoo.